It's an honor to me to be chairing this session, honestly, in front of all these great names. So maybe I would invite our first speaker to maybe upload his presentation. I'm going to try to read the name. I'm really sorry. I apologize. Well, the first presenter is Yoshitro Mawono. Did I pronounce this right, correctly? I'm sorry, Professor, I think you're still on mute.
Okay, sorry. Yes, is it okay? The voice and view?
That's
okay.
Perfect.
Thank you very much.
We see the slides and we can hear you and see you as well. So, I think you attended the previous lecture. It's 20, 25 minutes, and then we have Q&A, 5 to 10 minutes. Okay, the floor is yours. Thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you. Yes, let me start. Yes, my name is Yoshi Maeno. I'm at Kyoto University. This is Kyoto, Japan, 1 a.m. in midnight. And thank you very much for inviting me to this very interesting symposium. And I'm a physicist, experimental physicist. I'm synthesizing superconducting materials. And I'm really deep into the basic physics. I'm trying to make discover new superconductors. Now, I'm not sure I can tell you about the philosophy of chemistry, but I can at least give you my view on periodic tables today. Okay, so today I'll talk about three-dimensional atomic and nuclear periodic table of the elements. And after the introduction, I'll tell you about the three-dimensional periodic table, bridging the long and short form periodic tables. And then in the second part, I'll talk about nuclear periodic table based on the proton magic numbers. And then I'll tell you about the magical relation between these atomic and nuclear periodic tables. And the work is published in these two papers in Foundation of Chemistry the last year, and then also just recently, it just came out, and these two papers. And then my collaborator is Koichi Hagino, the nuclear theorist in our department, and Takehiko Ishiguro, the same as myself, experimental superconductor physicist. Okay, then let me start with the Mendeleev short form periodic table. So about 150 years ago, Mendeleev discovered this, invented this periodic table. And he had an interesting signature, 1869, February 17th. So this is the way he wrote the dates of the discovery of this periodic table. And then 2 years later, he has this refined version of table, and in which the, very interestingly, elements with similar valence tendencies are in the same column, right? So for example, calcium and cadmium, they are, tend to be both divalent, so they are in the same column. So as titanium and tin. All right, so this is a Mendeleev's law system, periodic system. Now, then who invented this prototype of the currently used periodic table? And this person is Alfred Wellner. Alfred Wellner is a very famous, well-known chemist. He got the Nobel Prize in the coordination theory, the first Nobel Prize in chemistry, he says, in inorganic synthesis. So he's very well known. However, his contribution as an inventor of the modern periodic table is not widely recognized. So I hope that his name is mentioned in high school textbooks as Mendeleev-Wellner's periodic table in the future. Okay, so this is Mendeleev-Wellner's periodic table, 1905. Now then, who invented this periodic table with the rare earth elements separated at the bottom to be more convenient for use? And this person is Pfeiffer. And Pfeiffer's name is even less recognized, even among the specialists. He reported, published this periodic table in 1920. And he was actually a student of Alfred Wellner. And Wellner, the Pfeiffer later took the prestigious Keckle professor position. So he's also a very well-known chemist. But his contribution to the periodic table is really little known. So therefore, in this paper published, just published, we introduce the details of his 1920 paper reporting this periodic table. Now, this is a comparison between Pfeiffer's table in 1920 and then Deming's periodic table. Now, Deming's periodic table is quite well known, often cited as the prototype of the modern periodic table. However, if you compare this, I think we should identify Pfeiffer's periodic table as the prototype of the modern periodic table 3 years before Deming's. Now, then this one compares the short form and the present day modern form non-periodic table. And then, so the long form periodic table, this IUPAC periodic table and similar periodic tables, based on quantum mechanical electron orbitals after Bohr model, right? So this is really logical in some sense and quantum mechanically correct. However, this Mendeleev's periodic law is not so explicit anymore. This, as I explained, calcium and cadmium are non-magnetic divalent ion. And this in the long form periodic table, this is this properties are not so well expressed anymore. So then are there any room for further improvements in the modern Wellner-Pfeiffer periodic table? And of course there should be some improvements. And here the shortcomings, I first need to tell that this Wellner-Pfeiffer periodic table is of course great and it's very useful and it's been used worldwide in South America too, right? And then for in Japan too, it's been used worldwide. But here I point out three shortcomings. One is this magnesium and aluminum are similar, but there is a big gap between these two. And then secondly, so it's convenient to have this elements, F block elements separated. But you know, now these elements are very important for high tech viewpoint, and this should be incorporated into the main table. And then the more importantly, as I explained, is Mendeleev's periodic law is not well expressed anymore. And in the old days, you know, these group two are called 2A, right? And then group 12 was called 2B, both are two, right? Because divalent, right? But now it's called 1 to 18. So then we can go back to this Janne periodic table. 1929, in which the S elements are placed on the right. And this is very nice, although it's a very long sideways, so it may not be so convenient to use. But here I indicated the tendency of valence tendencies. So monovalent and divalent atoms are on this column, as well as here, copper and zinc. And then there's a ytterbium among the F block. There's a weak tendency to be divalent in some occasions. And then trivalent and tetravalent elements are here and here. And then among the F block and trivalent and tetravalent non-magnetic elements are lanthanum and cerium and over here. So if you look at this, if you then combine S and P block elements together, and then compare with the transition elements and the F block elements. So F, D, and S plus P. Okay, these three groups will make it somehow very some logical, systematic. So the answer is rearrange elements in three tube helical periodic table. And that's been done here. And so this I invented about 20 years ago. And I named this element touch. You touch all the elements and so on. And there's some Japanese pun also included hidden in this word. And anyway, any element touch periodic table. And then this was a cover page of the monthly journal distributed to all the members of the Japanese Physical Society. So it's in physics that there's American physics today. So it's a counterpart of the Japan Physical Society. And then this was 20 years ago. Okay, now if you look at this, and previously this Janne and Schatten-Brandt helical tables have four tubes. That's natural, S, P, D, F. But here I have S and P combined. And this way, of course, all the element symbols are continuous and F and D blocks are treated more or less equally. And then more importantly, for example, if you look at this three plus column and all the non-magnetic trivalent elements lined up, like yttrium, lutetium, lanthanum, lawrencium, and so on. So this is a key. And same for the divalent and trivalent. So group 3 and 13 together as long as well as non-magnetic F block elements. Then this is Kyoto University goods, and you have a three pocket pen holder, and then you have a coffee mug, okay, and you have a t-shirt, okay. And then this being used in various TV series in Japan and movies. And so this is being used often. They showed up in the mass media. Okay, and then for public events, you can, I let students or people to have this sheets and then cut out in three pieces, and then using just a tape, you can make this kind of each participant can make this and take home. So that's been used for the public events. Now, to summarize the first part, the element touch periodic table bridges the short and long form periodic tables. It's based on the modern long form periodic table, and yet it can reproduce or recover the and express Mendeleev's law. So that's my periodic table. Okay, this is the first part. Okay, let me go to the second part, which is the atomic. Okay, so I start with the atomic periodic table, but we go into the nuclear periodic table. So as you know, these noble gas elements, helium, neon, argon, these are stable because the electron atom is stable when the electron shells are filled up with electrons. And so you have 2 and 10, and these are stable with the energy gap. Now, so those are the chemical inert gas. Okay, so everybody knows this. Then in the nucleus, there is a similar shell structure. And so nucleus is stable when proton orbital shells is filled up with protons. And these are proton magic numbers are slightly different from the noble gas magic numbers. So instead of 2, 10, 18, the proton magic numbers are 2, 8, 20, and 28, and so on. And the origin of the nuclear force was first predicted and explained by Hideki Yukawa at our university, our department. And then this Mayer and Jensen explain these nuclear magic numbers using their Schur model. And they got Nobel Prize in physics. So then why can nuclei form a shell structure? So for the electrons, atoms, we know that we have at the center, we have a positive nucleus, protons and nucleus. And then we have a Coulomb potential, 1/r, right? So this gives you the Bohr orbitals, right? S, P, D, F, and so on. But then for the nucleus inside, there's no central core, right? However, nuclei, protons are attracting with each other with a very strong short range force, nuclear force. And this is called Yukawa potential. And in addition to 1/r, you have exponential decay. So it gives a very short range. So for each proton, it looks like it's attracted to this potential well, three-dimensional potential. It cannot escape because of the attraction from other protons. So you can view this as one proton in the potential well, right? Okay. So then this case, then you have a harmonic well potential. You have the magic number 2820. So that's a nuclear magic number. Good. But the next one is 40. You cannot expand in 28. And then you have a more realistic Wood-Saxon potential where you see the splitting of the depending on the different orbitals. S orbitals and F orbitals have different energy. It's good. But still, you cannot expand 28. And then finally, Mayer and Jensen introduced this spin orbit interaction, very strong one, to have a splitting of the 1F orbitals into two. Then you can expand 28 as well as 8850. And then, so this spin orbit interaction is also existing in the atomic electrons. But in the nucleus, this spin orbit interaction is very, very strong. So this, depending on whether the spin of the protons are same direction as the orbital motion of the protons, you have a splitting. And this, the splitting widths is as large as like 5 mega electron volts. It's huge. So this really dominates the structure of the shell model. So then this is a chart of the nuclei and people use this. And then this is the way they, the specialists, nuclear physicists have expressed their the magic numbers. Okay, but then and they also discuss some similarities between this nuclear magic numbers and the atomic magic numbers, rare gas. However, the noble gas. However, are there any periodic table treating the magic number nuclei like noble gases? Periodic table of the nuclei? And the answer is no. And surprisingly, so why not? Let us make one. So therefore, that's why we made this. We invented this just last year in Hagino and Maino paper and the foundation of chemistry appeared last year. So this is the nuclear periodic table. So it's like a long form periodic table, but you see the, instead of a noble gas, helium, neon, argon, you have helium, oxygen, calcium, and so on. And these are magic numbers. Protons are stable, the nucleus are stable, right? And then different color represents a different orbitals, nuclear orbitals, proton orbitals. And then for example, 2s is here. P and S, 15 and 16 are 1s and 2s. And then D orbitals are split into the J equals L plus 1/2 and J equals L minus 1/2. And then in between this spin orbit splitting, S orbitals are inserted. So it's very interesting. So this way you can really see this what's happening to this nuclear orbitals. So I think this is quite useful, and people, nuclear theorists has never done this before, very surprising. Okay, so is this a periodic table? And the answer is yes, it's more complicated than atomic periodic table, but at least the deformation of the nucleus are very minimal at the stable nucleus, and then more deformation. So this may be useful for the NQR, you know, the NMR, part of NMR without any magnetic field. Because the, if this is deformed, then you can use these atoms, elements for the nuclear quadrupole resonance, NQR. And also the bismuth, so this is like alkaline atom, more unstable. Then bismuth is used for the, to create a super heavy nucleus, like a nihonium. Okay, so then we found some magical relation between these two. So this is atomic periodic table, familiar atomic periodic table, and this is this new nuclear periodic table based on proton magic numbers. So this represents the stability of the properties of the nucleus, and this is the properties of the atom, right? And then, but if you look at this group 14, we have our familiar atomic periodic table. In the group 14, we have tin, lead and flerovium, but tin, lead, flerovium are actually as proton magic number nuclei, right? So there's no reason for a nuclear magic number to align over here. And then the reason is that for the atomic one, the xenon and radon and organesson, so filling this radon and the organesson, you need to fill SPDF. So this 2k square, 32 elements are needed in between. So 54 plus 32, 84, 6 plus 32 will give you these numbers. However, for the nuclear case, this tin and lead and fluorine, the difference is also identical, 32. But these 32 numbers, 32 are rather accidental, coincidental. And because these 32 is determined by very complicated, as you can see, different colors, very complicated summation of numbers occupied by all different orbitals. So these are coincidental. But thanks to this coincidence, these 74 elements, arrangement of 74 out of 118 elements between niobium and 114 fluorobium are common between these periodic tables. It's just, not so important, but it's just fun. You know, for example, the F block elements, lanthanum, actinides, and everything they here are exactly reproduced here. And also you can see niobium, tantalum, dubronium, niobium, tantalum, dubronium. These are also here, niobium, tantalum, dubronium, right? So the atomic and nuclear periodic table accidentally have very similar arrangements. Okay, then you can make this nuclear periodic table like this, a paper model. Okay, so you have this magic number nuclei here. And then you can download this paper pattern and you just cut it. And then you using this tape glue and scissors, you can make this in maybe 20 minutes. Okay. And then this was also adapted as a cover page, top page of this journal distributed, monthly journal distributed to all the Japanese members of the Japanese Physical Society. Okay, so then this is a summary. So we have atomic and nuclear periodic table and depend because of the difference between the potential and the spin orbit interaction, we have different magic numbers and you can make different periodic tables. Okay, thank you. So this is the one, my presentation at the Mendeleev 150 year anniversary international conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Maeno. This is really interesting, and you have made it so accessible, even for as a downloadable version. So maybe we can move to questions. Dr. Sherry would like to start.
Yes.
Eric, Okay.
Thank you very much for your presentation, Maeno. It is indeed great to see this illustrated with models, and I understood more from this presentation than from your papers. A couple of comments, if I may. The first one is you were making a point of saying that the modern periodic table does not show periodicity explicitly. Now, that's true if one insists on periodicity being eight elements. But if you accept that period length varies, then the modern table does display periodicity. In other words, just by accepting that not all period lengths are eight elements, periodicity is captured by the modern form. So I'm not sure if this...
I'm telling you that the periodicity is well expressed. My point is the similarity of the valency.
Yes. Okay.
So where are the elements with two pluses or three pluses?
Yeah.
And here in the Mendeleev short form, it's this column two, 2A and 2B are aligned. Okay. But over here, it's split into group 2 and group 12. And without telling you, you cannot tell which one is a 2 plus, which one become 3 plus. That's the point.
All right.
So that's the similarity of the valency. Yeah. That's a Mendeleev periodic law.
Yeah.
That's the point, yes.
Okay.
So periodicity is very well expressed, I think, in this form, right?
Okay. One other point. Are you familiar with the periodic table of Fernando Dufour, who's a
yes,
friend?
Yes, yes,
okay,
yes.
Because that sure. one also captures this, what you're capturing with your version.
I know this very well, but no, it doesn't have this arrangement. Yeah, the one key is to look if calcium and cadmium are aligned, and it doesn't.
Oh, it doesn't? Okay, I would need to look at the model.
Okay.
Thank you both for this interesting discussion. I think Professor Sokomar would like to ask a question as well.
So much has been made recently of the closing of the periodic table at Organesson and Albert. From what you have shown, particularly when you get to the radioactive elements, the electronic stability is not all that important as the nuclear stability, right? And the nuclear period is not closing here at Organesson. So we can expect more elements and further, right? Is that your conclusion?
I'm not sure I can answer your question directly, but the Professor Pico has published the periodic table of the elements with the number up to 172. And you can imagine increasing the numbers more. However, nucleus become unstable, right? So if the nucleus are unstable, nuclei are unstable, then you don't form atoms. So there's no meaning of discussing the atomic periodic table, right? So this nuclear instability occurs around 150 and 170. So in that sense, it's meaningless to discuss atomic periodic table over 172. I think Professor Pico may be aware of this, and then when he published
well,
this.
It's an interesting discussion. Maybe we can touch on it again in the breakout rooms, but we'll give also, there is a new question. Arega, Mr. Arega, would you like also to ask a question?
Yeah. Thank you for the interesting talk. I have a coincidence between the in the case of the and the chronic period.
Jesus, I'm really sorry, but you're cutting off a little bit. We cannot hear you clearly. Maybe you can write your question in the chat.
Okay.
I'm really sorry.
I can read the chat.
Okay. In the meantime, if anyone else has a question or I can also. I think the chair is here now. Professor Jakob has joined, and maybe he would like to sit in the throne. Professor, are you here?
Yes, I'm here. You can hear me?
We can hear you and see you, Professor.
Yes, yes. Because of the telephone. So I'm a bit busy at the moment, but I would like to say hello. I mean, I was already here before, to be honest, but I had just had to get something else on because I just came home from the university, and I thought that I better put something decent on before you have some nightmares about massive anacondas tonight. So I think that is okay now. First of all, hello to everybody, and very nice talk. So Yaman, you want me to close this part of the
I think the question is in the chat. We have 1 minute. If maybe Mayeno,
have fun from,
Mayeno
from,
can, may you read the chat?
Yes, I can read
some
that.
Kind of correlation.
Yes, the one from Jesus Albertino James is not, is that the question? Could be some kind of correlation between the electronic structure and the proton structure due to the coincidence in the magic numbers. So the question if there could be some
okay.
kind of correlation.
As far as I know, the atomic structure, orbital structure, and the nuclear orbital structures are uncorrelated. It's independent. As far as I know.
Okay, and Eric Skerry was saying that he had asked the same question already, I guess, so that should be answered. So apparently no, the short answer to the whole question is no. Are there any other questions that anyone may have?
Well, maybe just to press the question a little bit, is it just a coincidence that some of the magic numbers are the same, just a coincidence?
I think so, yeah. If there is a correlation, the magic number, coincidence as far as we know. Yeah.
What is the energy difference, roughly speaking, between what's going on in the nucleus and what's going on in the electrons?
Yes, electron volts versus meg electron volts, 10 to the 6.
10 to the 6 different.
10 to the 6 different, yes.
So we shouldn't expect a connection.
No, so the deformation of nucleus may, you know, it may have some effect on the Madelung rule or something in principle, but I think it's not known. Okay. The energy scale are very, very different, yeah.
Okay, are there any other?
That's a very interesting question, yeah. Right.
Are there any other questions on that topic, or does anyone else want to drill a bit deeper into this magic situation? Then shout and scream or write in the chat. I think it has stopped. So Yaman, I think we can close this lecture now. I would like to thank our presenter once more for this wonderful lecture. So this was really very nice. So Itachi, thank you very much again for